this third Sunday in the season of Lent. Ever since the fall into sin, man has been in a spiritual battle with Satan. During the season of Lent, we look to Jesus, who takes up that battle as our substitute and as our representative. Today, that battle is described as the difference between sight and blindness. And Jesus makes us a promise that he brings spiritual sight to those with whom he's blessed faith, and judgment to those who are blinded in their unbelief. Our opening hymn is hymn number 28. May God bless your worship. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I cry out to the Lord, I plead for his mercy. Bring me out of the prison of my sins. God of light, we are born in sin and darkness, separated from you. We are blind to your word and your work, choosing to see only what pleases ourselves and fulfills our desires. Although you have called us to be children of light, we all too often go back to the fruitless deeds of darkness, sinning against you in our thoughts, words, and actions. For the sake of Jesus, who is the light of the world, we pray for your forgiveness. The Lord Christ, who died on the cross for you, has shined for you, making you light in the Lord. Therefore, in the place and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I announce good news to you. Your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May he who began this good work in you bring it to completion on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. The peace of the Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you show the light of your truth to those in darkness. Give strength to all who are joined in your family to reject what erodes their faith and follow your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. You may be seated. The first lesson for today is recorded in the book of Isaiah, chapter 42, verses 14 through 21. The Lord promises his helplessly blind people that he himself will lead them to safety. To those who reject the true God, he promises punishment. For a long time, I have kept silent. I have been quiet and held myself back. But now, like a woman in childbirth, I cry out, I gasp and pant. I will lay waste the mountains and hills and dry up all their vegetation. I will turn rivers into islands and dry up the pools. I will lead the blind by ways they have not known. Along unfamiliar paths I will guide them. I will turn the darkness into light before them and make the rough places smooth. These are the things I will do. I will not forsake them. But those who trust in idols, who say to images, "You are our gods," will be turned back in utter shame. Hear, you deaf, look, you blind, and see. Who is blind but my servant, and deaf like the messenger I send? Who is blind like the one committed to me, blind like the servant of the Lord? You have seen many things, but have paid no attention. Your ears are open, but you hear nothing. It pleased the Lord, for the sake of his righteousness, to make his law great and glorious. This is the word of the Lord. Our psalm is Psalm 143. It's on page 5 of your worship folder. The second lesson is recorded in Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 5, verses 8 through 14. Christ has transformed who we are. And because he has transformed who we are, he also transforms the way that we live. Since we're light, we'll no longer live in the deeds of darkness, but instead we'll live as children of light. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light. For the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, for it is light that makes everything visible. This is why it is said, "Wake up, O sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." This is the word of the Lord. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. Please rise for the gospel. The Holy Gospel for this third Sunday in Lent and also our sermon text is recorded in the Gospel of John, chapter 9, verses 1 through 7, 13 through 17, and 34 through 39. In this lesson, John tells us about a man who was born blind, but in God's plan, there's no such thing as coincidence. This man was born blind for a reason, not because he sinned or because his parents sinned, but so that the work of Jesus might be displayed in the life of this man who was blind. He was blind in two ways. He was blind spiritually because he didn't know Jesus as his Savior. He was blind physically, couldn't see Jesus standing before him. Jesus cures him of both. As he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus. "But this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. As long as it is day, we must do the work of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." Having said this, he spit on the ground and made some mud with the saliva and put it on the man's eyes. "Go," he told him, "wash in the pool of Siloam." This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been blind. Now, on the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was a Sabbath. Therefore, the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. "He put mud on my eyes," the man replied, "and I washed and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath." But others asked, "How can a sinner do such miraculous signs?" So they were divided. Finally, they turned again to the blind man. "What have you to say about him? It was your eyes he opened." The man replied, "He is a prophet." To this they replied, "You were steeped in sin at birth. How dare you lecture us?" And they threw him out. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, and he went and found him. He said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" "Who is he, sir?" the man said, and asked, "Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said, "You have now seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you." Then the man said, "Lord, I believe," and he worshiped him. Jesus said, "For judgment I have come into this world, so that the blind will see, and those who see will become blind." This is the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. The hymn of the day is hymn number 343. This is what the Lord says. He who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and all that comes out of it, who gives breath to its people and life to those who walk on it. I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness. I will take hold of your hand. I will keep you and make you to be a covenant for the people and a light for the Gentiles, to open eyes that are blind, to free captives from prison, and to release from dungeons those who sit in darkness. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, who have been given faith to be able to see the only Savior that there is. In January of 2016, a Royal Air Force pilot was conducting a routine training flight in a Hawk jet when all of a sudden this routine flight became anything but routine. And that's because in the middle of his flight, all of a sudden, he lost his ability to see. When he radioed the base, they thought about telling him to eject, but they were worried about the injuries that he might sustain while he was ejecting, and they certainly didn't want to ditch that expensive jet into the North Sea. That's when they asked another pilot to fly alongside of him and help him down. Just imagine that for a second. You can't see a single gauge on the instrument panel. Almost everything you depend on to keep that plane in flight, much less land it, depends on your ability to see. Now obscured by blindness as the result of some physical ailment that he was suffering. He couldn't see with his own eyes, but they asked him to see through the eyes of another. And that's exactly what they did. They brought that plane down safely and landed it. Seeing through the eyes of another. That's exactly what God is asking us to do today. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Christians in Ephesus, said this. He was talking about God's power, which he exerted in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every title that can be given, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. I believe that in that passage, there's a perfect illustration of why we need to see through the eyes of Jesus. Because it begs a question, doesn't it? If God is in control, if God has power, so much power that he can raise someone from the dead, if God is so much in control that everything, no matter what it is or where it is, must submit to him, and if this God has promised to guard me and protect me, then why does he allow me to suffer? I think that's a question that I've been asked more in my ministry than any other. If God is in control, then why in all the world am I still dealing with this? The disciples in this lesson, they asked that question not of themselves, but of this man who was blind in front of the temple. Blindness, it wasn't anything new to him because the man had been blind since the day he was born. And in those days, Jewish rabbis taught that blindness and other birth defects, they could be the result of some horrible sin committed by this man's parents passed down to the next generation. Or maybe God could foresee in this man's life something that he would do, something so horrible, and he was going to punish this man with blindness from birth. That's what the other rabbis said. Now the disciples wanted to know what their rabbi said. So why is this happening? And Jesus tells us there's no one answer to that question. In fact, he brings a number of possibilities up in this lesson. But there's a bigger lesson for us to learn here today. Jesus answers his disciples' question. He wants them to see suffering and everything else through his eyes. He wants us to see suffering and everything else in this life through his eyes, so we don't even have to ask the question, why is this happening to me anymore? Well, the disciples may have been wrong about this being the result of sin in this particular case, but they did put their finger on something that was very important, an important truth from God's word. Sin, consequences that come along with it. Remember, God taught King David that way, that in a very painful way. David had that adulterous relationship with the woman Bathsheba, and she became pregnant because of it. And so God sent the prophet Nathan to him to expose his sin, and David confessed his sin. And yet, in spite of the fact that he was forgiven, God said the consequence of that sinful action is going to be that this child is going to die. Wait a second. I thought God doesn't keep records of wrongs. I thought God remembers our sin no more. I assure you that's true. But sometimes, even though God saves us from the eternal consequences of our sin, sometimes he allows us to suffer temporal consequences because of our sinful actions. Because he wants to tell us, sin is serious business. And all of those temporary struggles that we deal with, they serve as a constant reminder, don't they? What a blessing from God, so that we never lose sight of the fact that sin is damaging. You do that with your own kids, don't you? You see your kid doing something dangerous, and you inflict a little bit of pain on the backside of his pants. Why? Not because you're angry. Not because you hate him, not because you want to punish him, but because you want to prevent him from an even greater harm that may come to him. That's the way it is with us too. Sometimes God allows us to suffer temporal consequences to our sins so that we don't lose out on the eternal blessings he has in store for us. He's much more concerned about your life after this life than he is in making you comfortable here. But Jesus says that's not the case here, not with this blind man. He wasn't being punished, and it wasn't even a consequence to his sinful actions. Jesus says, neither this man nor his parents sin. Sometimes sin is not about an action. Sometimes sin is about a condition. Not just in people's hearts, but in this very lit world in which we live. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Romans, said, for the creation was subject to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning, as in the pains of childbirth, right up to the present time. In other words, God created a perfect world. But every facet of that world has been corrupted ever since the fall into sin. That's why we have natural disasters. That's why we have illnesses like cancer. That's why people suffer in their lives. That's why we have birth defects like blindness. This world is broken. It's corrupt. It does no longer function the way God planned it out to work. But who is the one who subjected this world to frustration? It's God. God subjected the world to frustration because it's a blessing from God. If you had everything in your life exactly the way you wanted it, if you could build for yourself heaven on earth, why in the world would you ever want to leave? Why in the world would you ever want to leave this world behind for someplace else? But the fact is, we live in this world, no matter how good our lives may be, separated from the Father. Yes, He's removed our sins, but we can't talk to Him face to face. And we don't live with Him eternally. God allows us to go through temporal consequences of living in a sinful world so that we'll always want to go somewhere else. So that we'll never try to sink down roots here, but we're looking for a better place, a paradise that God has prepared for us where we will be in perfect communion with Him every moment of every day. Living in a sinful world corrupted by sin, that's a blessing. And seeing through the eyes of Jesus, you understand it's a blessing even when it touches your life. Suffering may be God's discipline to remind you how dangerous sin is, or it may be just simply the consequence of living in a sinful world to keep us focused on the idea that we're headed to a better place. But neither of those reasons explained why this man was blind, but Jesus tells us. This happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. And my guess is if the miracle didn't follow that statement of Jesus, we would have absolutely no clue what he was talking about. But the miracle is the perfect explanation, right? Jesus spits on the ground and he mixes the saliva with the dirt and makes a mud poultice and puts it on this blind man's eyes and tells him, go and wash in the pool. And all of a sudden, John tells us he can see. Not just light as opposed to darkness, not just some fuzzy, hazy images like when they do those amazing surgeries today. That's all they really can see at first because the brain can't even comprehend the images that it's receiving. John says this man came home seeing. Clear, crisp images, vivid hues of color, all for the very first time. That's God's power being displayed in this man's life. The problem is that when God's people see that, they don't always recognize it. When the Pharisees heard about this man being cured of his blindness, they wanted to know how it happened, and they were divided about it, how it happened. Some of them saw that this must be some special power from God, but some said, oh, no, no, no. You see, in those days they taught you could save somebody's life on the Sabbath, but you couldn't improve their life in any way. And since Jesus healed this man of his blindness, improved his life on the Sabbath day, they thought, there's no way this could be the power of God at work. You know, I wonder sometimes if we don't come to that same assessment when we see God's power today for a different reason. How many times haven't we mistaken God's power for the skills of a surgeon? Or for some miraculous medicine? How many times haven't we looked at those things and attributed them to science rather than to God? Those are blessings from God, aren't they? To have a skilled surgeon, an insightful physician, a medicine that comes from the things of this earth? And yet, who is it that gave the surgeon his skills? Some scientist discovered some cure, but what were the raw elements that went into that cure? Things that God created. And who gave that scientist the insight to be able to see, if I give this person this treatment, it will in fact help them? That's the power of God. Seeing through the eyes of Jesus means recognizing that sometimes I suffer so that God's power might be displayed in my life. Sometimes I need to be reminded, and I need to see through the eyes of Jesus to recognize that it is God's power. So what do we say then when the medicine doesn't work? Or when the surgeon is able to skillfully cut out the tumor, most of the tumor, but part of it is left behind. Does that mean that God's power then has failed? Sometimes God demonstrates his power by not taking things away, by not preventing them from coming into our lives, because he wants to strengthen our faith. He wants us to demonstrate faith and to live in faith, to recognize our own weakness and to see that our real power is from God, to understand what the apostle meant when he said, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made complete in your weakness." Even those things, when God does not take it away, when the medicine doesn't work or the surgeon misses something, those two are blessings from God. You can only see it when you see it through the eyes of Jesus. Jesus didn't use science. He used mud to heal this blind man. So what was the reason for his suffering? Did you notice that nobody was willing to give credit to God for that miracle? All of his neighbors, they looked at him and they said, "Man, he sure looks like the blind man, but maybe he just looks like him." That was their explanation. Or this man's parents, dragged in front of the Pharisees, they were able to testify, "This is our son. And he was, in fact, born blind, and now he can see, but how he can see, we don't know." The Pharisees, they called for the blind man to get the word straight from him. And when he suggested that he was cured of his blindness because of a prophet, they kicked him out of the temple. But the point is, every single time this man was pressed, he had an opportunity to witness. He had an opportunity to tell people exactly who it was that restored his sight. And John reports that that's exactly what he did. Sometimes God allows us to suffer so that we have opportunity to witness. Some of you may know that a few weeks ago, my cousin was injured in a helicopter crash, and he sustained broken bones, but I think the biggest injury was that he had injured his spinal cord. And right now, he's down in Atlanta in a rehabilitation center, and he's in a wheelchair. I don't know if he will or if he will not ever get out of that chair. But I want to tell you something that's absolutely amazing. There are a lot of bad things about Facebook, but there's some good things too. I go on Facebook, and I see what he has written. And I listen to his wife, and I see what my cousins wrote. I hear what his friends are saying, and it's not sadness. It's not frustration. It's not questioning. It's not doubt. It is God's people echoing the promises of God and rejoicing in the blessings that he showers upon them, even in the midst of suffering. My faith has been strengthened because of that, because of their witness, and God giving them the opportunity to see it as an opportunity to witness. Some of you are doing the same thing. A couple years ago, one of our members came to one of our midweek Lenten services, and here's a man that has seen some tragedy in his life. One of his sons killed in a motorcycle. Another one of his sons, motorcycle accident that put him in a wheelchair for the rest of his life. A son-in-law killed in a plane crash. And so as he's driving down Meridian Road, he comes to the intersection of Meridian and University, and the light is green, so he goes through the intersection, but there was a motorcycle coming from the other direction who didn't see the red light and slammed directly into his vehicle. Horrible, horrible suffering. Not just for the man's family, the man who had died, but also for the man behind the wheel of that car. Why did it happen? I don't know or I remember all the details about how they learned this, but they found out that the man on the motorcycle was not a believer, and his wife wasn't a believer either. And I don't remember all the circumstances, but somehow, some way, this wife of the man on the motorcycle got in contact with the family member of the member that was driving the car. And they asked, "Do you think your father prayed for him when he was dying?" And he was able to say, "Absolutely, yes. Absolutely, yes." Tragedy. Horrible suffering, and yet unbelievable blessing of God, because the last words that lost person in unbelief heard was the words of the promises of the Savior of forgiveness and life and heaven. Maybe, just maybe, that man died on the road out there, but now today he lives in heaven because God gave one of his people the opportunity to witness. But it's not done. They found out also that this woman, the wife of the man who died on the motorcycle, she wasn't a believer either, but today she is. Today she received faith in her Savior who took away her sin. She now knows that she has life. How did that happen? Because God used his people to witness. Sometimes that's why God allows us to suffer. Or maybe it's one of the other reasons that I've always mentioned. We just don't know when we're going through suffering for sure the reason why. But there's always something we can be sure of when we suffer, and that's the fact that God is going to use us. He's going to draw us closer to him. That's what Jesus did for the man in our reading. When he heard that the Pharisees threw him out of the temple, Jesus went out and looked for that man again, because he wanted to give him something even more important than the ability to see. He wanted to give him the ability to see everything through the eyes of Jesus, not just the things of this earth, but all the way to heaven. So John says, "When he found him, he said, 'Do you believe in the Son of Man?' 'Who is he, sir?' the man asked. 'Tell me so that I may believe.' Jesus said, 'You have now seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you.' The man said, 'Lord, I believe.' And he worshiped him." He worshiped him because he understood that Jesus was his Savior, the Son of God in human flesh. Why are you suffering? Because Jesus wants you to see everything through his eyes. And he wants you to know. It may be for all of those other reasons, but it's definitely because he wants to bring you closer to him. You maybe ask, "Well, why do I need that? I already see Jesus as the Savior. I already recognize him as God." Well, then I guess we have to ask ourselves, how many times haven't we questioned what God is doing in our lives? How many times haven't we tried to whisper into the ear of God and let him know about our better plan? The reason we ask those questions is because we think we deserve something better, or at least something different. But that's true only if your life belongs to you. And it doesn't. You are not your own. You were bought at a price, the price of Jesus' blood. Therefore, don't use your life to serve yourself. Rather, honor him who rescued you. Your life belongs to him. We deserve something different or better? That's only true if God doesn't care about you. It's only true if God doesn't understand your suffering. But let me ask you this. What is the cross other than evidence of God's love for you? What is happening on that cross other than Jesus suffering and knowing exactly what you're going through and so much more than we can possibly imagine? What other possible explanation could it be? Because Jesus becomes blind to my blindness to him. Jesus chooses not to see my rebellion against him. Instead, he supplies me with his righteousness and holiness. And then he carries my guilt all the way to the cross. And he pays for it with his blood. And he promises me that through his resurrection and faith in that resurrection, so also I have life. God doesn't understand us. God doesn't care about us. Can't be. When you see the cross through the eyes of Jesus, then why am I suffering becomes a question that you don't even have to ask anymore. Am I suffering because of one of my sins? It's forgiven. Am I suffering because I'm living in a broken world? It doesn't matter because I'm headed to a better place. Am I suffering so that God can demonstrate his power in my life? Lord, make me your tool. Am I suffering so that God gives me an opportunity to witness? I'm going to witness no matter what. Am I suffering so that he can draw me closer to him? Make it so. Lord, give us the eyes to see everything in life and everything in between this life and the next through the eyes of Jesus. May the Holy Spirit grant that in all of us. Amen. The peace of God that transcends all human understanding, guard and keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Join with me now in confessing the Nicene Creed. It's on the bottom of page 7 and top of page 8 of your worship folder. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. will gather our thank offering. This is also an opportunity for you to sign the friendship register if you haven't already done so. Dear Savior, help us to believe that when you ask us to worship you with our gifts, this is not just a business proposition, and surely not an invasion of our privacy, but rather an exercise of our faith and a fitting response to the mercy you have shown us. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for calling us out of darkness into your marvelous light. For the gift of sight, which enables us to see your wonderful works of creation, we give you thanks. We admit, O Lord, that we have not always used these gifts to the greatest advantage of your kingdom. Our spiritual insight enables us to know your will, and yet we have often acted contrary to your commandments. May your Holy Spirit enlighten us to the mysteries of your word. Give us clear insight that we may confidently lead others into your light. Hear us also, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Now to you be praise and glory, dear Lord, who came to set us free from our spiritual darkness and brought us into the light of your saving gospel. We join in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. We lift our hearts in praise and song to thank you, bless you, and honor you, O holy, gracious Lord. It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who willingly died under the curse of this world's sin, so that we may live forever in the light of God's blessing. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. May this strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Thank you. still life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen.
God, our Heavenly Father, you have fashioned us to praise and to serve you. Empower us to fulfill your purpose for us in all our lives. We confess that we have often placed our own interests and desires ahead of your will. In your mercy, let us be forgiven for the sake of Jesus' satisfaction in our place. Reach into our hearts through word and sacrament today so that from week to week, we may more joyfully and more consistently devote our time and energy to those things which will be of value for eternity. We ask this in the name of our only Lord and Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you peace. You may be seated. We'll join in hymn number 560.